Nanjira, Sambuli. Nanjira is awesome. Also, she's a researcher. She's an advocate. She's a self-proclaimed tech geek. She works on technology issues and how we impact governance, equality, entrepreneurship, social culture, many cool things. Most importantly, we went to high school together. So we went to kind of high school, I mean, in careers. So, Nanjira's talk today is Another Side of Geek. Thank you so much, everyone. Give a round of applause for Nanjira.
Hi, everybody. Such good energy, and I will do my best to be entertaining. So, I'll start with a bit of a story about me. As you guys, full and finished product of the April 4 system. One thing I did when I was thinking back to that system is I realized when I put it, it was very great transitions. So I belong to the first cohort in the PCP system that went from the 7 subjects to the 5 subjects. So it's not being great from the knocks. And then when I went to high school, here in we were also in the transitional phase. And I remember because like the guys behind us were getting new books, very like cute, and they were looking so nice. I see them there. They know they were reading Shakespeare. I said they were watching it strong. By the time I was going to your annual, people were out for any of them in the past. Was around the time people were breaking out. So it was such a suspicious, just mind your own business. One time we were kicked out of class because a new security collector or something around that would be anything happened, we were totally in class. And so sometimes I think to that system and being a product of it. And I realized the things it taught me, not necessarily the work that told me, right? The thing I realized about it before was really challenging us to be called to the week. You know? Just go through that, answer the questions, get your 20 out of 20, go through your Saturday course, and then that. But for my school, I learned that with curiosity. Not ask questions from class, but find somewhere else to ask them. In university, I realized, well, nobody gets the right to ask about what you're doing. So you can do whatever you want with semester. And so this is probably what I did. Some of you know that I dabbled in music at some time. So I explored that because from primary to secondary school, you always feel that it wasn't hard. And when you go to school at Walmart, even now you say, you feel that's not the hard. So I did that like maybe 2 months in the semester and then went back. Still graduated because I wanted to be actuarial science, because that's what you do. But also why I did actuarial science was not for the reasons that they were sexy, it was a new cool thing in math. But I realized we're not going to have problems about subjectivity in math. That's the beauty of math. Numbers are water. I'm sorry if you had bad teachers, but numbers are very low. So I realized if it's proving 1 is greater than 0 or 0 is not equal to 1, we have to understand the logic, but really not much else to discuss. So I found survival system. And so when I was not surviving, I realized, I definitely was not going to try and do all the papers to become a chicken, actually. There's some here, there's more for you. I looked around and I was like, okay, what next? And everyone was now in the mobile phone, it was exciting. And Pesa was big, space was coming up, the energy around Silicon Savannah was coming up. Oh, that's cute, I like it. So we got companies like Safaricom to use the type of customer care and pay us. That was like the service level, and I said, I'm asking you questions. So, okay, what next? What would this mean? Did some research at some point around how social media was impacting how we get to work, what was happening around the country, how was connecting people, not just in Nairobi, but in the country. And then I started to get more and more curious and digging deeper. So, okay, we're being told tech, mobile phones, yay, Africa rising, woohoo! But who's shaping the narrative? So, fast forward, and what I do now. The thing I realized is there was no course that was going to prepare me for that. I work at the World Wide Web Foundation that was set up by the inventor of the web, so TMS. And we work on making sure that internet is a human right and a public good. It sounds sexy, but it's very complicated. In a world that likes to prioritize everything, it's such an uphill battle to get this thing to be delivered to everybody equally. So that it's not about function of how rich and how poor you are. So that's the policy that I work from. It is not sexy, but it's hella fun. And I have questions like, who gets to decide that the narrative about Africa is a global first continent? Who gets to say that? Who gets to design the platforms we use, the things that become so central to our lives? Who creates the narrative that then we run up with and say, this is the future of share, it's an app, it's Bitcoin, it's AI, artificial intelligence, guys? If nothing else, the picture is there's so much to be done there. And the thing I've learned is that while there wasn't a course that they have done to teach me, I still don't know if there's any, I'll check. I also was such a bad student, I don't think I did that again. The thing that has gotten me and gotten me to the staff and working on this issue globally, starting from Kenya, Nairobi, home base, always forever, is that relates to kids, especially in a world. So now we've finished schooling for this event, so we're surviving the adulting, we're trying to figure out what's wrong with Tinder again. The thing is, in that system, you very quickly stop thinking. Just having spaces to think. Just having spaces to question. One thing I found is we then have, especially in Nairobi, we become very good at surviving. Due to the stories that have been going on around CBD and everywhere the money is, all of us probably have, how do I make sure I don't wear the earrings, I don't wear the shoes, I get the up because I don't want to be cut off. That's the work we get into, and the space to question what it will really take to change that, then it's not our job. And so you keep surviving until the system, knocks you out of that. But there's something a previous colleague of mine has said, I should have been there, that for Africans, the thing is about rehabilitating your right to think, your right to question, your right to just say we are not just facts. Africa isn't just because it is, and especially the narrative we have. This is doubly so for young women who are African, who are Africa, trying to make it to the stats that, all the stats against you. It's not only rehabilitating your right to think, the next thing you know, you budge into rooms and you go like, actually, I belong in the room, I've got some questions, and I've got some problems with how you're going about this. That's a lot of job, basically. And last but not least, the tech, I'm going to make a pitch, why tech? I'm not a coder, yes, I'm a mathematician, there's a lot of money in data science now, but I hate so much work. The thing I've learned is, there's so many other avenues to get into that. We need the anthropologists, we need the history guys, we need the artists, we need people to shape the narrative around how tech impacts our lives, and to really help us assess whether it can help us with addressing the many inequalities that we know all around us. The narrative so far has been it's an app that's a solution. Right now, Bitcoin is all the rage. But my friend, the Kenya power is big the most. How are you going to be mining that Bitcoin? What you've been told is the mobile phone is big and that's it for me. So the Africans have the mobile phone for other devices. How are you going to participate in that thing when it becomes the norm? So those are the things I work on, and that's the policy side of tech that is super important. And the other thing about it is you learn, especially if you work in tech, the narratives around me from you. No Bitcoin without power. No laptop chair without power or a good country. We can't see from this idea that we will leap from tech is really a false sense of security. And this is the last thing I'll say that has been said so many times is we will not entrepreneur our way out of bad public policy. Whether in tech, whether in health, whether in education, the sooner we get that, the sooner more of us are speaking that talk wherever we are, the quicker we'll actually get this stuff working for us. So if we have to be a time, guys, our parents are still waiting for their turn, we're waiting for our turn, the kids coming after us are coming with such speed, we can't keep going with the system the same way it is. So in a nutshell, that's what I do, that's who I am, and I really look forward to seeing more thinkers from different domains looking at this convergence of this technology and applying to the various domains to make a case for the fact that we too have a space to an agency to create for how tech will impact our lives. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much, and cheers.